while we're standing, let's take our Bibles and open them to the book of Titus. Titus chapter 2. Titus chapter 2. It is right after 2 Timothy and just before Philemon. There's only three chapters. It's kind of a small book tucked in there. And if you get to Hebrews, you've gone too far. You need to go back a couple pages. Titus chapter 2. Let's read verses 11 through 14. I'll begin in verse 11. Please join me on verses 12 and 14 out loud together. Titus chapter 2, 11 through 14. For the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. And let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for, again, we thank you for your word. Thank you that we have a way of knowing you. And thank you for being a God that wants us to know you and who reveals himself to us in something that is indestructible and unchangeable. We thank you for your preservation of your word, keeping it pure, holy, and known to be so. We ask that you would open it to us today and help us to open ourselves to your word, to you. May we be helped and strengthened. May we hear from you, and we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. I like all of this. I have underlined in my Bible verse 11, and I just want to say something about it. I'm not preaching about that, but we did read it, and that I get excited about that. I used to wonder about, and the question arises, what about people in other areas of the world that have never heard about, and usually the ones that are asking this question are critics of Christianity. They've never heard about your white man's God. Well, first of all, it's not white man's God. And he is the God of all.
Amen.
And so, but the question is, it would be unfair for him to send somebody to hell that never heard about him. Well, okay, that's very true. I'm going to allow that statement to stand. It would be unfair for him to send somebody to hell that never heard of him. And that's only a true statement from man's perspective. The fact of the matter is, it's unfair for God to take anybody to heaven. That's what's unfair. If we want fairness, we've all sinned, and we deserve to spend an eternity in hell with our back broke. That's fair. That's justice. We have done wrong, and if God's justice was what ruled, then we would each be punished. So, but from man's point of view, well, it's just not fair to send that one to hell and take this one to heaven. Okay, so there is an apparent disparity there. They say because that one never heard and that one never knew, and so it's just not fair for him to not have a chance for heaven. All right, so in order for that accusation to be addressed, God said, I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll talk to him myself. I'll talk to everybody myself. And verse 11 tells us this, the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men. At some point or another, the Holy Spirit of God speaks to the heart of every human being and says, you need to be saved. You need a relationship with God Almighty. Now, whether they respond to that or not is now on them. The ball is in their court, so to speak. It's their turn to do something. And mankind all over the world at some point or another has walked out of a tent, out of a stick lodge, or out of a cave and looked up and said, there's got to be a God up there. And when he says, God, I want to know you, well, before too long, a missionary shows up and says, I want to tell you about the God of heaven, the God of all creation. Because the Bible has another promise, seek and ye shall find. So every man that responds to that that first urging by the Holy Spirit of God to their heart, by seeking and wanting to know God, God is obligated, and he fulfills that obligation in making himself known to them. Now, that's good stuff, and I almost wish I was preaching on that now, but that's not what's in my notes, but that's, you know, and I think, I don't remember who it was, I'm going to make up names, but if my memory's right, then it was Larry King. If my memory's wrong, it was somebody else. Ask Billy Graham, well, what about the people in Africa or some back isolated village somewhere that have never heard about Jesus? Are they going to go to hell too? And I don't think he gave a biblical answer to that question. Here's the bottom line. If somebody dies without having Jesus as their Savior, they spend an eternity in hell. It's just as simple as that. But nobody dies without having Jesus as their Savior without excuse. I mean, they all, with a valid excuse, I should say. The grace of God has appeared unto all men at least once. At least once. Those of us in here, it appeared more than once. He himself spoke to our hearts, and somebody else either knocked on our door and invited us to church, or took us to church as kids, or gave us a gospel tract, or shared the message of the good news of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ in our living room, or on our front porch, or in the garage. Or I led a fellow to the Lord in Walmart once. I said, this really is a saving place. For him, it was. And I've led people to the Lord in the gravel driveway in front of their garage. I've led people to the Lord inside the garage, in the living room, in the kitchen, on the front porch, on the back porch, on the side porch. It doesn't matter. And for so many of us, the grace of God, the message of that appeared to us more than once. First, it was God himself spoke to our hearts about it. And then second, somebody else came along. And that helped establish that as a truth in us. And thank God for those that respond and accept Jesus as their Savior. They seek him, and he says, I promise you, you'll find. Now, I want to look down here, though, verse 13. And this is where our text is today. Looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Now, here's a verse right here that tells us Jesus is the great God. So if anybody says, well, Jesus isn't God, he's God's son, well, they need to read this verse. Uh-huh. Because that's what we're looking for. We're looking for the return of Jesus, and this verse calls him the great God.
Amen.
Now, and in case you were wondering which one, it's the one who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. Now, I want to talk about that hope there. Hope, that word hope. I looked it up in the dictionary. I like to look up words that I think I know the meaning of. Not just the ones I wonder about. Because I've found so many times there's words I thought I knew what they meant, and turns out I only knew a little bit of what they meant. Or I had an understanding of it, but I couldn't really put it into words to explain it to somebody else. This is a word I had a pretty good understanding knowledge of what it meant, but as far as conveying that to someone else, I thought that's what the dictionary people got paid to do, and they so many times are so much better at it. Here's something I found in my good old Webster's dictionary. Hope. It said a desire of some good, accompanied with at least a slight expectation of obtaining it. That's hope. By itself. Let me say that again. Let me read that again for you. And let it sink in. A desire of some good. So we say, well, I hope it's a nice day tomorrow. I hope it doesn't rain. I hope that person makes it home okay. I hope to be in church. I hope to do this. I hope to do that. And so that's a desire of some good. I hope I have a good meal to eat for lunch today. I hope it isn't burnt. I hope it doesn't have onions. You know, we have a desire for some good. Accompanied with at least a slight expectation of obtaining it. There's at least a slight expectation. So hope just by itself, just a simple, regular, ordinary, run-of-the-mill hope, at the lower end has a just a slight expectation of whatever it is we're desiring coming true. So that means hope, and I'm talking about just regular, average, run-of-the-mill hope that anybody could have, has a possibility to have a large possibility of that event never happening. Looking for that blessed hope. Boy, thank God for all the words in His Word. It's not just looking for that hope. Because if leaving out the word blessed, just looking for that hope, and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior Jesus Christ, then that means, by the very definition of the word hope, if that's all there was, just the word hope, there's a large possibility it would never happen. Folks, our hope's a better hope. It's not an ordinary hope. And that's point number one. We're one third of the way through. And it's only a quarter after. So I'm not going to make any plans or promises. But listen, isn't that something? When we just think of that one word hope, and the world has hope, and people hope for things. People pay their hits, they cash their check, and they take that cash and they go to the gas station or some convenience store, and they have a hope to hit it big on the scratch-offs. Now, can you go do that somewhere else? I want to pay for my gas and get out of here. And from my perspective, one of the best things gas stations did was let me pay at the pump and not get stuck in line behind somebody in there that's wasting their entire paycheck. I remember when my son asked, "Dad, what's the lottery?" He had heard that term somewhere, and I said, "You've been hanging around your mom too much." No. He said, "What's the lottery?" And I said, "Dad," I said, "Son," I said, "I have heard the lottery called a tax on the unintelligent. I would never say that, but I have heard it called that." And so I would quote somebody else in saying it freely, and I do often. And I said, "Here's what it is they sell all these things, and people scratch off, hoping to win more money than what they paid in, but they don't." I said, "One might." And they put that on the news and how excited they are and everything else, and so that excites everybody else to go and start throwing their money into that. And it goes into a big pot, and then one person wins, and they take a little piece of that pot and give it to them, and then they spend this other stuff. I remember when the lottery was up for election in this state, and here was the promise made: we'll never have to raise taxes for education again if you just say yes. Well, it looks like that was a lie, so they need to... what they should have done is, if we ever have to ask for taxes again, that we'll do away with the lottery. That's what they should have done. An evangelist I know that used to pastor near here, one of his church members asked me, he said, "Preacher," he said, can you give me some money for gasoline so I can get to work this week?" And he said, "Sure," and he gave him, I don't know, $10 or something like that. That's back when that would buy gasoline to get you back and forth to work. Not to get you out of the driveway like today, but anyways, the fact, "Oh, thank you so much, preacher," he said, I was just sure I was going to hit it big this week." And he had taken his paycheck and spent it all on the scratch offs. And if I called the preacher's name, the blacks would know who I was talking about. I'll call it, it doesn't matter. Brother Woodard looked at the man and he said, "Don't ever ask me for a dime again as long as you're wasting your money on the lottery." He said, "Don't ever ask me for another dime as long as you're throwing your money down that toilet." But that man had a hope. But it's just an ordinary hope. Well, I hope I'm going to win. I hope I'm going to hit it big. I hope this, I hope that. But that ordinary hope has a possibility. Now, it might be more than a slight chance, but it at least has a slight chance of being accomplished, and so or obtaining that which you desire. But that means there's a possibility of there being a very large chance of you not obtaining that which is. That's an ordinary hope. And the hope that we have as God's children, as God's people, the hope that we have is not an ordinary hope. It's a blessed hope. And that's point number two. It's a blessed hope. I looked up the word bless. And my dictionary has three columns on each page. And the word bless took up an entire one column of that whole page. And I'm not going to read all the definitions and everything, but I found some that I liked. One of them means to praise or to magnify. It's to say something very good about and just build it up. It means to make happy. So, boy, he really blessed me. You're saying, well, he really made me happy. When we look in the Bible, it says, blessed is the man that does this, this, and this. Or blessed is the man. It's saying, in that context, it said, here's a man that has a bone-deep happiness. Just all the way through to the core, he's happy through and through. And so it means to make happy. It also means to make successful. And so here's a hope that, having that hope, it's a blessed hope. It's going to be made successful. When that hope is fulfilled, it's not going to disappoint. Having that hope makes me happy because it is a blessed hope. See, it's not just a regular ordinary hope. A regular ordinary hope could disappoint me. In fact, a regular ordinary hope could have a high probability of disappointing me. Well, you see the people, they pull out their lucky quarter. They're scratching off. Ah, I lost again. Boy, and that shocked you? No, I saw it coming. College students and professors and scientists have been studying rats and mice for years, decades and decades. One of the things they like to do is make a maze and put cheese on one end and release the rodent on the other. And that rodent will learn and memorize the maze after running it a few times. And if they put the cheese in the same place, pretty soon it doesn't make as many mistakes. It goes straight, the most direct path it can to get to the cheese. Some college students decided, I wonder what humans would do. And they got to talking and trying to set up a maze and what they would do. And they said, well, not everybody likes cheese. I saw a t-shirt that said, I can't please everybody. I'm not bacon. And so I would have said, put bacon on one end of it. But anyhow, they said, most people will, you know, put some money in there. They'll go after, especially college students. They'll, you know, hey, there's going to be $20 at the end. And what they did was they hid money at different places throughout the maze. And they said, sign up here. We're doing a study. We're running a test. And they observed. They had their clipboards. And they're writing down their observations. What, you know, they're up above the big warehouse. And a human-sized maze for these kids to run through and find the money. Their study came to a close. They told all the participants, we're done, it's over. All the money's been found, thank you for your help, and enjoy the money you got. Now, a mouse they found, and a rat, when they quit putting cheese in the maze, they quit running it. Now, as long as there's cheese in there, they run through that maze, and they... But when they quit running, when they quit putting cheese in it, they run it one or two times and say, I'm just going to hang out here. They told the human beings, there's no more cheese in this thing. There's no more money in it. And people were breaking in. They were cutting the locks off the warehouse in the middle of the night to run that maze even though there was no money there. Because they had a hope. They might find something this time. They might get something this time. And they failed again and again and again. In fact, every attempt after the study was over was a failure, and they were told it was going to be a failure. They knew they had a very high probability of failure, but people aren't really all that smart all the time. And they're behaving on a, listen, how much more should us as Christians behave in a certain way and allow ourselves to be happy that we have something, it's not just a regular, ordinary hope, we have a blessed hope. And that word blessed means to make successful. So when somebody comes along and they help you succeed at what you're attempting, you say, they've been a blessing to me. Well, you have a flat tire on the side of the road and you're struggling to get that fixed, and what you're wanting is, I'm hoping for a repair here. And somebody comes along and they help you effect that repair, they blessed you. They made you successful. And so, and I would say that would make you happy. And that would be something to magnify and to praise and the other definitions of the word blessed. And we have a blessed hope. And my last point, number three. What makes this different, this blessing different, is that it's blessed by God Himself. It's blessed by God Himself. My dad told me a joke. I think this is one of the last new jokes I remember him telling. I mean, he had thousands of jokes that he told in different places. I remember when I was little, I'd say, tell the joke about, and I would give the punchline. And he'd say, no. And finally, one day I said, Dad, how come you never tell the jokes I ask you to tell? He says, you always give them away. He said, you need to word it, your request differently, and then once you ruin it, I can't tell it. It's ruined. But the last joke I remember him telling, he may have told others after this, but the last new one that I remember him telling about this guy that went to the barber shop. And the barber and his wife both worked there. The barber's name was, I don't know, Fred. And his wife's name was Grace. And they had prices for the different services. And they had a haircut, so many dollars and this. Had a shaving by Fred, that was $5. Shaving by Grace was $500. And the fellow said, why is it more to be to $500 instead of $5? He said, once shaved by Grace, always shaved by Grace. And it's a play on words, saved by grace is forever. Because what God does, He does forever. See, I could bless somebody, I could make somebody happy, and that happiness could be taken away. I could praise somebody. I could bring one of the kids out that's in the back right now and say, what a good job you did, and praise them about something that they earnestly did right. And they could turn around and walk away, and before they made it back, somebody could intercept them and say, you ruined this, and they'd undo that whole praise that I had just given. I know he said you did a good job at that, but I remember the time that, and they could fill in the blank with something negative and destroy the praise. I could help them to be successful, and somebody could turn around and thwart that and cause them to fail. I could help them to be running outside, and somebody could jump out and trip them and cause them to fall. And so man can praise, and man can magnify, and man can make somebody happy, and man can make somebody successful, but when man does it, it can all be undone. See, what I'm saying is the hope that a man provides can be taken away and destroyed. And so I'm glad that the hope that we have is not a man-made hope. It's not a man-blessed hope. It's not an ordinary hope. It's not an average, run-of-the-mill, at least a slight expectation of obtaining the desired good, which means there could be a large expectation of failure to obtain the desired good thing. No, it's not that kind of hope. Because at best, that's the kind of hope that man can provide. When you go to the doctor and the doctor says, we're going to have to do surgery. And you say, can you guarantee success of that surgery? The doctor says, no. I mean, it doesn't matter how complex or simple that surgery is. You could be going to have a wart taken off of your toe, and they're going to have you sign a paper that says, this could kill you. I mean, everybody that's had any surgery knows you're signing a paper, or somebody is signing that paper for you. You could die while you're in there. I'm not saying that to discourage anybody from having surgery, but I'm just saying, at best, that's what man can provide. Take your car to a mechanic. Are you guaranteeing that this is going to fix it? And some mechanics say, guaranteed all the way to the end of the driveway. That's the best we can provide. The word warranty and guarantee, those words have kind of taken on meanings that are not as powerful as we as consumers might want them to be. I'm glad we don't have something that was man-made. You know, even the stuff that has a lifetime guarantee. I bought some, there's a certain brand, and I won't say what the brand is, but at the time that I bought it, their brand, they said, this has a lifetime guarantee. Oh, right. And it was some insulated overalls, which if you're working out in the cold, it's nice to have those. Insulated overalls. And in that store, they said, our own brand got a lifetime guarantee. Okay. I would use these maybe 3 times a year. That's the only time it would get cold enough where I said, I absolutely have to have those. But 3 times a year. After a few years, I may have worn them maybe at the most 30 times. At the most. And the zipper just came undone. I said, these have a lifetime guarantee. So I went back to the store. I was there for something else, and I said, I'm going to ask them about my insulated overalls that I bought right here at this store. Has their name on it? And I said, I have a question about your lifetime guarantee. And they said, what's that? I said, I bought a set of insulated bib overalls here, and they're your brand. And the zipper has broken on them. And they said, well, when did you buy them? And I said, it's been a few years back. And they said, oh, that's only good for a year. How's that count as lifetime? It's the lifetime of the product. They expect their product to last a year. And the lady was very kind. She said, let me ask the manager what we can do. So she called the manager on the phone, and she tells him my story. And she says, we can give you 20% off of something. You know, if you want to buy another pair, we can give you 20% off on it. I thought, your definition of lifetime guarantee is a little different than my definition of lifetime guarantee. That's man's. That's the best hope he could provide. That's the best hope they could give. We got a better hope. We got a better hope. There's some religions that offer a hope, and it's just so easily taken away because a man somewhere created that out of thin air. And he has no more power to back it up or to keep somebody else from destroying it than he has to make the sun go dark. But I know a God that can make the sun go dark. Mm-hmm. He's going to do it. The Bible tells us we're going to get to a point where the sun doesn't give its light anymore. But the light all comes from Jesus. He's done it before. If he can make the sun turn on and come into existence just by speaking, he can certainly turn it back up. And that's the God that has the power. And he blesses this hope, which means since God says, I am going to make it successful, there's not anybody that can keep it from being successful. What is that blessed hope? It's the return. It's the coming back of Jesus. Let me find it. Looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. I'm saying this morning, he's coming again. We know that for sure. Not just because he promised it. Not just because, oh, I hope Jesus comes back. Like a regular hope, I have a blessed hope that Jesus is coming back. It's blessed by God himself. And there's no power anywhere in heaven, in earth, below the earth, above the earth. There's no above heaven, but beyond any scope that we could see or imagine or perceive, there's nothing that can keep it from happening because God himself is the one that blessed it. It's a blessed hope. He says, I will make it successful. If you ever get down, discouraged, and sad, oh, what's going to happen? Oh, everything's going wrong. Oh, the politicians are doing this. The judges are doing that. The market is doing this, and I haven't got my stimulus check, and I don't know, and how many more checks of these can they write? There's no funds in the bank. They're writing these. How is it that their checks don't bounce when there's no funds in the bank? And ours do. And that's just not fair. And what? You start getting down and discouraged, and this didn't go right, and the weather's gloomy, and the weather's sunny, and it's hot, and it's cold, and it's just right, but I can't go out because I've been quarantined. Just whatever it is that gets you down in the dumps, open here and find out we have a superpower hope, an omnipotent hope, a blessed hope. And see if that doesn't make you happy. And if that doesn't make you happy, check your salvation. I don't care if Jesus comes back. You need to be born again. You need to be born again. This is something that God has praised and God has magnified. And he's designed it for our happiness. Hey, there's nothing that we're going to have to endure here that comes close to comparing to the glory that's going to be revealed in us there. I look forward to that blessed hope being fulfilled. It's not a run-of-the-mill, ordinary hope. But what hope do Christians have? Well, we hope Jesus comes back someday. I don't know. I know. If you don't know, you're reading the wrong Bible. Not everything that says Bible on it is a Bible. I saw a book that said Handyman's Bible. There wasn't a single verse in that thing. They shouldn't be allowed to use that word for other things. They shouldn't be allowed to use that for other for versions. They should be honest. This is what we think God was trying to say. They call it that. We have a blessed hope. Let's make sure we remember it. And that we tell others about it. Let's stand today. Every head bowed again. God has blessed that hope himself. There's nothing that's going to stop it. That eastern sky, that split open, is going to be like a light from the east to the west. As the words come up hither ring out and that trumpet resounds, the dead in Christ shall rise first. Sitting on the couch next to my wife last night, and I said, tomorrow would be my dad's birthday. I got my calculator out to see how old he would have been today. I guess he's still, I don't know, there's no time in heaven. If he'd have still been here, he'd be 85 today. And as I talked, I said, you know, that makes me wonder if Lou Gehrig's hadn't taken him, if that disease hadn't ended his life, would he have lived to 85? He had diabetes, he had blood pressure problems, he had some other health issues. And she mentioned to me, she said, you wouldn't want him to be back the way he was. He's better now than he ever was here on earth. And she's right about that. If I'm still breathing, walking around here, when Jesus comes back, my dad will rise first. The dead in Christ, all those who have been saved, are going to come up first. And I'll be right on his heels. Then we which remain shall be caught up in the air. I'm so glad that's not just something that is an ordinary hope. Because those ordinary hopes are prone to fail. But that's a blessed hope. And it's blessed by God Almighty Himself. Our Heavenly Father, thank you for the comfort we find in your word and its power. God, thank you that nothing has ever thwarted your power. Nothing has ever become a challenge to you. Never had something put you back on your heels that you had to come back and recover from. Lord, thank you for this promise, for the effect that it can have on us. Lord, help us to remember it. May your Holy Spirit bring it to our mind, in the forefront of our thoughts, every time we begin to get discouraged or sad about something. That we have a hope that no others do. We have, as your children, a blessed hope. May it have a good effect on our lives, in such a way that that light begins to shine to the lives of others. And they look at us and say, something different about them. I want to know about that. The word peculiar just means different. Help us to realize that we don't have to be odd just for the sake of being odd. But that if we keep that blessed hope alive in ourselves, it'll be a light to others also. Bless this invitation. But we ask it in Jesus' name. Place. There's something been discouraging you, got you down, got you worried, got you fretting and anxious. You just leave that on an altar. We have a blessed hope. Great event we're looking forward to, the coming of your only begotten Son. May we look forward to it. May we be excited about it and tell others how how they can participate in it by being born again. We ask you in Jesus' name.